Well, Stoicism has enjoyed quite the comeback as of late. The ancient philosophy of happiness has started filling the bookshelves of local bookstores and haunting the corridors of social media. You can't go far on ye olde Instagram without being confronted with good old Marcus Aurelius, or one of his less quotable comrades, telling you to go get your life together, subdue your passions, control yourself, and just be happy, and all that jazz. Heck, you'll even find Seneca quotes littering my own Instagram account, as well as in many of my videos. The problem with these books on Stoicism and self-help gurus and the Instagram Stoic bros, and even the problem with my own videos, is that they don't give us the full picture of what Stoicism really is. We can't understand something like Stoicism from disjointed tweets or social media posts. And the people who post this stuff are usually not experts in the first place. Their marginal understanding can only give us a one-sided perspective of a philosophy that is very complex, very diverse, and might look very different depending on the philosopher in question. And in many places, Stoicism actually cuts against what we would consider to be moral. In fact, there are some things in Stoic teaching that are genuinely horrifying, things that we should not ignore. I want to tell you a story that you're probably not going to find in a self-help book or a lifestyle blog. At least I hope you won't find it there. It comes from Seneca's 77th letter to Lucilius. In that letter, Seneca tells us about a man named Tullius Marcellinnus. And good old Marcellinnus has come down, it seems, with a disease. This disease was not incurable, but it was protracted and it seems very troublesome. And so, Seneca tells us that Marcellinus began to contemplate suicide. Now, Roman society did not stigmatize suicide as our society does, so it was not unheard of to discuss something like ending your own life with your friends. And this is exactly what Marcellinus did. Suicide is a momentous decision, so Marcellinus calls together some friends to ask for their advice, and everyone gives him their 2 cents. Of course, some of them told Marcellinus to simply take whichever course he felt urged to take. They're like those friends that you have that tell you just to listen to your heart. Not super helpful. It seems other friends might have tried to dissuade him, flattering him perhaps that he was too important to leave the world, although that's not clear. Seneca simply tells us that some of his friends flattered him. But then, Seneca tells us, a Stoic friend came forward. And Seneca says that this Stoic friend gives the most inspiring advice. This is what that Stoic had to say. "My dear Marcellinus," he said, "you mustn't let this worry you as if you were having to make a great decision. There's nothing so very great about living. All your slaves and all your animals do it. What is, however, a great thing is to die in a manner which is honorable, enlightened, and courageous. Think how long you've been doing the same as them. Food, sleep, sex, the never-ending cycle. The desire for death can be experienced not merely by the enlightened or the brave or the unhappy, but even by the squeamish." And by squeamish, I assume the Stoic friend means that it's not unnatural for people who feel sick, squeamish, like Marcellinus, to want to kill themselves. At any rate, Marcellinus is completely convinced. He buys this line of thinking hook, line, and sinker. He decides, yep, he's gonna kill himself. But the thing is, he's so sick and weak that he needs someone to help him do it. So, he turns to his slaves. But his slaves are like, "Nah, man, we don't want to kill you. That would look bad." And it seems that maybe even his slaves kind of liked him. So the Stoic friend goes to work on the slaves, and he convinces them that they should, in fact, kill their master. He actually says that commanding their master not to kill himself is worse than actually killing him. So the slaves are like, "Okay, if you say so, we'll kill him." So what they basically do is they set up a steam tent in the bedroom and with a warm bath, and Marcellinus, who hasn't eaten for 3 days, just kind of slowly passes away in the steam bath as the slaves keep filling the bath with warm water and I guess their own tears. It's kind of a horrific sight. However, Seneca concludes by telling Lucilius that this is an example that, quote, has practical value for the future, meaning presumably that we should take this as an example of how to accept death, welcome it, and face it cheerfully. And I think there's actually some good advice here concerning how to face death, and I plan to do a video on that in the future. But there's an obvious moral problem for us here on the surface, and that is suicide. And not just the act itself, but actually encouraging someone to jump off that cliff. Someone who is hesitant to take his own life. Pressing him to say, yep, just do it. And it's not like we're talking about something like a terminal illness here. While apparently Marcellinus was suffering quite a bit, I guess, it was an illness that he could have recovered from. He could have gone on to live. But the Stoic philosopher says, no, it's not really worth it. And I think that's really the biggest problem here. It's the devaluation of life. The idea that, quote, it is not an important matter to live, as another translation renders it. The Stoic essentially reduces life down to eating, sleeping, and reproducing, and nothing more. Which, by the way, many scientists and pop reductionists do in our own day as well, which I find to be quite insidious. I have to ask, just as Jesus did, is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Isn't life more than reproducing and surviving? The Stoic equates us with animals who similarly eat, sleep, and reproduce, but Jesus asks, are we not worth more than birds? Is there not something profoundly meaningful and valuable in the mystery of consciousness, of intelligent thought, which in the great mystery of being we both produce and are produced by? If scientists cannot solve the hard problem of consciousness and explain how the brain produces phenomenal experience, if it even does, we don't know. If we can't explain that, then shouldn't we maybe hold off on degrading the value of human beings? Well, Stoicism doesn't hold back. One of the core tenets of Stoicism, one that is not discussed so often on social media, is that we must devalue things. In the introduction to the Penguin edition of Seneca's Letters, translator Robin Campbell summarizes Stoicism this way. The Stoics saw the world as a single great community in which all men are brothers, ruled by a supreme providence which could be spoken of under a variety of names or descriptions, including the divine reason, creative reason, nature, the spirit or purpose of the universe, destiny, a personal God, and even the gods. It is man's duty to live in conformity with the divine will, and this means, firstly, bringing his life into line with nature's laws, and secondly, resigning himself completely and uncomplainingly to whatever fate may send him. Only by living thus, and not setting too high a value on things, which can be at any moment taken away from him, can he discover that true, unshakable peace and contentment. So Stoicism involves stripping away the value from the things in our life, and ultimately from life itself. And it really does make sense. If your goal is to apathetically insulate yourself from the emotions of fear, sadness, and grief, you have to devalue things. When you lose a penny, you're not bothered by it, because it's worthless. But you are bothered by the loss of a crispy new Benjamin, because its worth is much more. You aren't bothered by the death of a cockroach, because it is not a valuable creature. You are bothered by the death of your parents. So in order to not be bothered by anything, you have to make everything a penny. You have to make everything a cockroach. In order to take the sting out of loss and fear and death, you have to remove the value of things. Now, personally, I am all in favor of putting a small value on things like wealth, possessions, career, even pleasures and creature comforts. But I'm not willing to similarly devalue the life of human beings. Nor am I willing to say, like the Stoics, that because things like death and suffering are inevitable, they are therefore to be accepted as good or right. Marcus Aurelius says in Book 4 of his Meditations, very famously, that all things that happen, happen aright. So just pause for a moment and think of all the worst atrocities and crimes committed against human beings. For the Stoics, those things are good. They are right, because they are ordained by the divine logos. And because you should conform your will to the divine logos, you should therefore love the things that happen to you. Again, Marcus Aurelius, Meditations, Book 7, love that only which happens to thee and is spun with the thread of thy destiny. For what is more suitable? Oh, I don't know. I think I could probably think of a few things more suitable, but at any rate, I admit that I have a grudging respect for this approach to life. Amor fati, love your fate. Love what has happened to you. As Nietzsche describes, it is the hard times that are the most fruitful. The things that don't kill you make you stronger. And I appreciate the Stoic logic, which says that even though things appear evil, it logically follows that if God or the divine logos, the ens realissimum, decrees it, it must therefore be good, even if you can't quite understand that. And it's quite a powerful foil to traditional expressions of things like the problem of evil. If there was one group of people for whom there certainly was no problem of evil, it was the Stoics. I can appreciate that, but I just cannot accept the part of Stoicism that says that everything that happens is right. I would rather believe in a Leibnizian deterministic God who decrees evil that good may come, rather than believe that all that happens is in and of itself good. There is a dimension of Stoicism that is a philosophical Stockholm syndrome, cajoling us to love that which abuses us, to deem that abuser good, and to declare that we ourselves are not so valuable things after all. I think that this is unbelievably cruel. I think Stoicism is in some respects one of the cruelest philosophies ever to have existed, and that no amount of peace or apathy is worth buying at this expense. These cruelties are baked into the cake of Stoicism. They are essential to Stoicism, insofar as Stoicism's metaphysics are maintained. They follow logically from its core principles, which is a problem when so many people are identifying as, quote, Stoic without knowing the dark side of Stoicism. So many people today want to maintain Stoic ethics while discarding the Stoic metaphysic. Now, I'm a firm believer in the idea of praising and adopting ideas that are good while condemning and dispensing with the bad. And you will often find me praising Seneca and the others, and I will continue to learn from them. But we should never, I think, speak of Stoicism as a whole in such flowery terms. Nor should writers and self-help gurus be allowed to capitalize on Stoicism without being challenged. We need nuance. And if you want to listen to me try to work through that nuance, then hit that subscribe button, because like I said, I want to apply Seneca's thoughts on accepting death to our modern pandemic and our modern political situation, but it's obviously a very sensitive subject, so I want to make sure I get my thoughts right and try to speak as precisely as possible. So that's going to have a separate video on its own. As always, I'm so thankful for all of you who watch these videos. If you have strong thoughts on this topic, then let me know in the comments or hit me up on Instagram. Your comments help me make better videos and help me to become a better thinker. If you thought the video was meaningful, then hit the like button. That's always very encouraging to me, and it will tell YouTube to promote the video more. With that said, thanks for watching, and I'll catch you next time.